Your Power Automate flow triggers when an item is updated. Later, an action fires that updates the item. In turn, your Power Automate flow triggers when an item is updated. Later, an action fires that updates the item. In turn, your Power Automate flow triggers when an item is updated. Yeah, it was a cheap shot, but I couldn't resist. So yeah, if you're watching this, then you too have faced the infinite trigger loop. If you haven't, then well, it's nice to know that you turn to me when you get bored. I'm here for you. Anyway, let's identify the infinite trigger issue, how it starts, and in principle, how you can prevent it. So here's a flow that is triggered when a SharePoint file is uploaded or modified. Now it can be a SharePoint list item or a file or a planner task, a form, many scenarios fit this situation. Lower down, I have a SharePoint update file properties action. Now when this runs, it modifies the data in columns and triggers the when a file is created or modified again. And we go on forever, or at least until you meet your flow run or API call quota for the month. The problem is the flow cannot identify between a user update and a flow update. And this is because the flow is using the credentials of a user account to execute the commands. In many cases, people tend to run flows using an account of a real user, ideally themselves. So you need to come up with something unique to one or the other that the trigger can identify before it executes. Now, in the early days, you had to add a condition within the flow, meaning the trigger fires and the flow ran before it got to your condition. And this meant it counted as a run in your run history. Nowadays, you can add trigger conditions. If these conditions are not met, the flow does not run and it does not count as a run. A trigger condition uses the same expressions you would normally add in an action using functions and values in the expressions window. Problem is, trigger conditions don't have the intellisense pop-up that you normally see. So you can cheat and write your conditions in a temporary action that displays the expressions window, like a, initialized variable or compose action. Then copy and paste the expression back into the trigger condition box. The trigger conditions require an at sign at the beginning for them to work. If you've not come across this, the at sign in expressions, it just allows the use of a function within an expression when it's not entered via the expressions window. So I'm going to show you two examples in this flow where I can prevent the loop. You'll need to think of some kind of object or data you can use to identify if it was triggered by a user or if it was triggered by a flow action. The flow checker should spot that you have applied an action that may cause an infinite trigger loop. The downside is it will not highlight which action or actions has caused this, so you'll have to do a bit of hunting around if your flow is lengthy or contains actions within scopes or control steps. Now, I need the trigger and the action. I cannot change either, but I have some options here, so let's take a look. When the file is modified, the modified by updates with the user account that made the change. The field name for the SharePoint modified by column is actually called editor. Now, we use an unattended account or a service account that runs many of our standard flows with only the free Power Automate license, so we don't pay anything per month. That means we can have a separate account manage the flow updates and allow us to identify whether it was the flow or a person who updated the document and not cost us a penny. And you can probably do the same, have an account that uses the free Power Automate license and create many of your flows with it. Being free, it will not have access to certain data connectors such as Outlook or Microsoft Forms, but you'll know this when the connector can or cannot be used. If you need to use these data connectors, then you'll just need to use a subscription account such as an E3 or a business license. If you're going to do this, you're best to create the flows from scratch with this account. The free license has limited flow management ability, but you may be able to at least swap the credentials, providing you add them as an owner first. And then reassign each action to the account. Now my flow is being run by an account, not accessed by a user. The modified by will allow us to identify whether the file was last updated by a person or this unattended account running the flow. So how do I get the flow to check to see if it was a system account or a user? So I'm going to go into the trigger and to settings and add a trigger condition. If you know exactly what you need, you can type it in here after an at sign. If you're not completely fluent, then there is no IntelliSense to guide you. So add an action such as compose or initialize variable, and you can use the IntelliSense to help you build what you want as a condition. Now the trigger condition must be true for the flow to run. So I'm saying as long as it is not the system account, then you can run. So I need to verify the account who was the last editor. Now you could check the editor email address, as this is a nice and easy. However, my free account does not have a mailbox. It doesn't use a business or E3 license. So the address is login only. So I need to check the claims user principal name that is used for logins. And you can also use this if you want to identify external users that do any changes to your SharePoint stuff. Now you don't have to follow this because I've pasted the code into the description below. So all you need to do is just change the email address to that is user@domain.com. You can change that. Or instead of using claims, you can just rip that all out and just use email instead of claims and make it easier for yourself. Once you've built the expression, click on OK just to make sure that it checks the syntax and validates it. Saves you a lot of time. And then you can just double click on it, select all the content in the expression, cut it out, and then you can then delete that action. Go back into your settings, into the trigger condition, and paste it in. Don't forget it needs an at sign at the beginning first. The other example, if you really get stuck on telling the difference between a user and a flow update, is to check how long it's been since it was last updated. So if the flow last updated less than a minute ago, then it's too soon and we can stop the flow from running again. So I need a date column that my flow can update as it updates the file. It must also include the time as well. We want the date and the time to be modified, just like the modified column does as well. But for brand new documents, there must always be a date in here, otherwise it will crash. So I'm going to set the default date in here to something in the past, and I'm going to use, January 1st, 2021 for that. That'd be fine. Now I'm going to go into my update file properties and this process column that's here now. I'm going to add UTC now. This is just going to give it the current date and time that it is now. And of course, that's going to trigger the flow again, but it's going to be so quick within milliseconds. And that's what I'm going to use to detect in the trigger conditions how that document was updated. So I'm going to put this into a temporary action again, just to use the expression window. And then I'll copy and paste it back into the trigger conditions. But the trigger condition is going to check to say, well, as long as it's not less than or equal to a minute after the update, then it's fine. You can run the flow. If it was less than a minute, then it was way too soon. But you can adjust that. Instead of using a minute, you can use seconds. You can adjust this as you want. So I'm going to do a not less than equal to. And I'm going to grab the date and time of the modified, but I'm going to use ticks, and ticks basically returns the date and time in a massive instance, like 100 nanoseconds, like a tick, as they call it. So it's going to be a lot more accurate. And then compare that to the time. in the process column, but I'm going to add 1 minute to that, so I'm going to give it a 1 minute gap. But the important thing is that when I put this code, and this code will go in the description window again, so you can copy and paste it, and there are two things really that you need to check. One is the column name, and make sure it meets the column name you're using, but also the time that it needs to check, or the variance of time between the two updates. I'm only going to do a minute, which is, again, more than enough time, and realistically, very rarely would I have a user update it that quickly. So I'm going to put this into a temporary action again, just to use the expression window to validate the syntax, and then I'll copy and paste it back into the trigger conditions. So I've now used two trigger conditions, one that checks the user account in the modify by, and one that checks how quick it's been since its last modify. I could actually use both and add multiple trigger conditions. As long as all of them are met and they are all true, then the flow will run. In this case, though, I'm going to check one of them. So I'm just going to check the date one and see how good that is. Okay, now it's been a week since I last ran this, I think. So actually, I'm going to create a new one. I'm going to create a new quote. And I'm going to let it update. I'm going to leave that be for a little while. There you go, I've left that for quite some time, and you can see that it ran some time ago, a few minutes ago, and normally, as you can see below in the row history, the run history there, if it had a constant loop, it would have run within minutes of the next one, usually within the next minute, in fact. So if that doesn't work, you can increase the time to, 1.5 minutes, 2 minutes, whatever time you need. But really, it should be quite swift. The trigger should run very much after the user update. You shouldn't have much problems with that. Click like, click subscribe. You can connect to me through Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, the usual. So keep them coming, keep connecting, and I'll get back to you and work with those answers as best I can. Stay safe and have fun.